Time is short, so make sure you don't waste it. Have more efficient game nights. We help you get the most out of your game night on episode 252 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
We'll also be talking about recent plays of Hamburg with our first time trying out some of the optional content, an epic game of Eclipse Second Dawn for the Galaxy, and our first plays of a couple small box games from Envyborn Games. We finish off with three detailed reviews tonight, which include King's Coalition from new game company Play to Z Games, then The Crooked Crown, a Take That game from Outset Media, and the Jaws Robot Pack for Robot Quest Arena from Wise Wizard Games.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hello to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights, Eastern, 8 p.m. at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop, and it would be awesome if you joined us in the lobby, our chat room. This episode was sponsored by Grand Gamers Guild and made possible, in part, due to the support of our Patreon patrons.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode252. That's 252. Links there may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
And some games mentioned tonight, including our three reviews, were provided by publishers.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
Tonight's question comes from Nicholas Bruyer.
Nicholas asks, how do I get more games played when most of my time is spent working or parenting three kids? Okay, I can relate a lot to this question. Like, our kids are getting older now, so they're more often with us at the game table than not, but there have definitely been seasons in our life when finding time to game was hard. Mm-hmm. And if your game time is limited, the answer to how do I get more games played is to make the most of every gaming minute that you can scrounge up. In short, you get more games played by optimizing your game nights or game afternoons or game Sunday mornings or whatever, wherever you fit in game time.
I would say, though, just make sure that when you're optimizing, you aren't, again, forcing anything on anyone.
Yes.
Your kids aren't interested in playing four games in 5 hours. That's fine, too. But if you do want to get more games in and you just don't have the time, here are some tips to get things done. And this doesn't always just include family. This could be friends as well. So one thing, especially if it's not family, if you're not just trying to organize the people in your own house, have an RSVP system in place. Make sure that you know when you do have gaming time scheduled, that you know who is or isn't showing up in advance.
Yeah, that is very useful to know. Know who's going to be here, who's not. Make sure you know your event's on or not. Make sure you're going to have enough players. Make sure you have games picked based on the appropriate number of players. And have plans for cancellations. Actually, we've got an episode. I'm not going to pull out the number off the top of my head. But we actually have an episode about game night cancellations you may want to check out for some contingency plans.
And I know we have wasted countless hours of game nights sitting there because someone didn't show up. And then we had to change the game we were going to play because the player count changed and all of our plans for the evening had to change. So that's like baseline rule number one. Figure out how many people are going to be at the table.
And to go with that, pick a night, right? Right. Pick a steady time, a steady place. Have it so that if possible, it's at the same time all the time so that people can plan around that and can, you know, take the time off. And I don't mean necessarily take time off work, but, you know, plan around a set time. That's definitely a better way to do it.
Yeah, well, we have spoken out against game night, you know, family game night. Everyone has to be here on Thursday nights for family game night. Having it regular is great. Forcing people to go, not great, but having it regular so that everyone knows in advance that Thursday night is game night isn't a bad thing at all.
Yeah, around here, it's Sundays at Brenda's. Not the kids play sometimes. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes Deanna doesn't play. So one of the things you can do, and this sounds counterintuitive, but one of the ways you can spend more time playing games on your actual game night is to play with your games ahead of time. Have some lonely fun with your games. Have them ready to play when you get there. Punch cardboard, read the instructions, do all the things you can do to have the game ready and ready to play on game night. We've mentioned it before. You never want to be in the situation where you're cracking the shrink on a brand new game with everyone sitting down to play it at that time. Yes, that worked for some of the, you know, original hobby board games when the instructions were in the top of the box and some, you know, simple card games. But for most hobby board games, you're going to want to spend time ahead of time. You don't want to have your friends help you punch out the cards or punch out the cardboard and sort the cards on game night. Have that done ahead of time.
Yeah, that might be an option for some people. There's actually no reason why, if you have the time and you're willing to take things slow, you can't do that. Maybe you've got friends who enjoy punching games with you. But again, that's not what we're talking about tonight. Tonight is all about maximizing that game time, taking that, you know, block of time that you have available for games, maybe once a week, maybe less than once a week, maybe once every 2 weeks, and making the most of that so that you're getting the bang for the buck of gaming money you're spending.
Even better is if you organize a game, do some component organization. Like, at a bare minimum, you should be using the baggies that come with the game or ones that you provide to sort the player components and resources. And unless you've tried it out and decided you want to play with it every time, you should have the expansion content already separated out. Because I know we've wasted a lot of time trying to remove all the expansion content so we could play without it at the beginning of a game. Having everything in the box well organized will just make your setup time much quicker.
Absolutely. The trays or whatever it may be. Now, in addition to reading the rules, which I think is pretty obvious, if you're going to sit down and play a game, it really helps if someone has read the rules first. Check Board Game Geek. See if there are any FAQs. See how many FAQs there are. Find out if the forum has 16 pages of rules questions. And know that you may have some of those questions yourself when you sit down and play, if the game has that going for it already. While you're at Board Game Geek, see if there's any player aids. Maybe there's something already out there from other users who can help you get that game playing faster, smoother. And you can check places like the Esoteric Order of Gamers or even the publisher's website to see if there are any additional tools, rules updates, or accessories to help you play faster.
Now, another thing I recommend before playing the game on the big night, you're all looking forward to the game on the weekend, is if you can, get it played ahead of time. Like, play a sample game, either at low player count or by yourself. Now, if the game includes the solo rules, that could be one way to do it. But more often than not, go through and just play two hands, play two players, play against yourself. You don't have to finish the whole game. Just kind of play it till you kind of get an idea what the game's about. If you can find someone from your game group that'll be willing to come over, say your game night's Sunday, and they're willing to come over during the week before the playing game night, play through a quick two-player game. Now, for us, we usually try to do this with Deanna and I. We'll try to sit down before I bring a game out to a public play game night, or even before we bring it to Brenda's on Sunday, so we figured it out. Same with if we're going to show a game to Sean. We try to make sure that we kind of know the game before Sean sits down to play it. Now, I've actually started doing this with Gwen, because Gwen has more free time than Deanna has. So actually, our most recent first plays of games have been with her instead of with Deanna.
See, I'm not sure on that one. I mean, yes, it can help with your game running smoothly when you sit down on game night, but it takes time, and we're talking about not finding time for gaming, and now you're trying to find more time for gaming to pregame the game. So I'm not sure. But if you have the leisure time for it, yes, it could be helpful. But instead, I have a huge time savings tip, and that's once you have figured out the rules, you share the best resources you found with the other players. You email everyone PDF copies of the rule book, find the best how to play video and share that, all of those things. The quickest game nights you will ever have will happen when you sit down to a game where you all know how to play.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, even if you all know how to play, you still got to get it out of the box and get it set up. And for some games, this can be troublesome, especially some of those boxes that don't have inserts or don't have good inserts. And you stored it vertically, and oh, was that a mistake? So take the time, if available, and again, this is sort of a balance of time. It's time outside of game time, but getting it set up ahead of time. Maybe you've got a pot on the stove. You're waiting for water to boil. Run downstairs and take those 10 minutes to get some games set up. Have it ready to play. Shuffle the deck. Seed the board. Starting resources divided before people show up so that everyone can get a quick refresher and hit the game running.
Yeah, you'll never see a bigger smile on your player's face than when they walk into your game room and the game's just there, ready to play when they sit down. People love that. Now, if you can't do this, again, you don't have time, or maybe you're meeting at a public place somewhere where you can't set the game ahead of time, or you're going to someone else's house to play, make sure everyone takes part in setup. It doesn't have to be the owner of the game or the game teacher to set up the game. Pass decks around to be shuffled. Have one player sort the resources while someone else puts the starting tiles on the board. Have someone do a quick search on BoardGameGeek to make sure there's no, rule errata or recent changes. have everyone kind of share the workload at the beginning of the game so you can all get playing quicker.
Yeah. I'm going to go back to component organization. So assuming you've played the game before and you know your group likes it, spend some time or maybe even some money on optimizing the organization for some of your favorite games. Split the components up in ways that help with setup. Look into purchasing or making a box insert. Keep an eye out for things that'll help you set up quickly, like trays that can be just handed out to the players or component containers that can be put right on the board or table.
Yeah, if you can actually take your components out in their tray, put that on the table and people take and put back into that tray, half your setup and put away is done and gone right there.
Yeah, the only thing here is just make sure you know the game ahead of time. So you don't want to spend a ton of time on this if you haven't played yet. This is something that once you know you like it, and you know, because I've often sat there and I unbox a game and I sort everything into baggies. I tend to do that by default. Well, once I play once, sometimes I did it all wrong. It ends up that I actually want these two resources together, and this thing doesn't come out until halfway through the game, so it can be left in the box until the start. And while these components I thought went together aren't even used in the same phase or whatever like that is. So to me, this is something you do after you know the group likes the game to kind of make it even better next time, even quicker.
All right. So for a lot of this, you need to know what you are playing ahead of time. So that's another big step you can take. Decide what games you're going to be playing ahead of time before game night. If possible, nail down the specific games. But if not, at the very least, limit the option. Walking into a room filled with games like behind D and Mo can be disastrous. All of a sudden, the AP doesn't come from during the game. It comes from choosing the game to play.
Now, one of the things that's worked really well for us are the board game menus, which we've mentioned on the show multiple times now. And man, people on social media love them too. Those, though, are the ones I make are mostly set up for larger scale public play events where we've got, you know, 40 games on the list. But don't be afraid to use a smaller version for your own game nights and then send the menu out ahead of time. And then the best thing that can happen is if you can get the menus out ahead of time, make sure everyone gets in their order before the event so that you can plan out the evening and what's going to get played and try to make everyone happy and all of that fun stuff ahead of time. By throwing it on a menu, you're going to get a better response. I don't know what it is. It's just you went through the effort and it just looks cool and there's something thematic about it versus, hey, what do you want to play on Saturday, right? Here's five choices. Pick one. Everyone let me know what your order is. We're going to go with the most popular options.
Yeah, no, all of that. Also, be sure to use tools like Board Game Geek and also your own experience with play times and players' experience levels to figure out how long the games are going to take, to schedule a full night of games and making sure you allocate enough time for each game. Like, you don't want to feel rushed, right? But you do want to fit in what you were planning on playing that night, and you want your expectations to be realistic. You got to keep in mind when you're learning a new game, things are much slower. Like, as a rule of thumb, we usually allow for double the playtime listed on BGG if it's the first time we're playing a game.
Absolutely. Now, if you are planning on playing multiple games, one option that can save a lot of time is to leave the cleanup for later. Yeah. Now, this may seem wrong, and many people may cringe at the very thought of this, wiping the table into the box top. But that may be the best option, especially if the owner of the game enjoys the lonely organization time. It also makes sure the owner gets to put the game back in a way they like it. And I can speak from personal experience that when you have things like public play events, not everyone grasps that, oh, this is how the game should be put away, that you think you understand.
Yeah, this one is actually a tip I got from a local gamer who loves that lonely fun, loves to organize their game, and after every game will tweak how their game's organized so that they can organize it better for next play. And they said, please, please do not put anything away. Do not put anything in a bag. I will do that after you leave. That's part of the fun for me, and it'll make it so that I can organize things better. The way you put it away is not how I'm going to want it put away. Please, please don't touch my game. And now we're saying box wipe or sort of table wipe into the box top. It doesn't have to be that. Don't damage components. Be careful with people's games, especially if they're not yours. But you get the gist. Just get it off the table as quick as possible and get the next game going. Now, this is also somewhere where game organization can really help. Now, have everyone help clean up. If you're not going to do the box top wipe, if you do want everyone to help, everyone should be involved. Everyone should help you clean up the game. And to me, that's a thanks to the host or to the teacher or the owner of the game for thank you for letting me use your game. I'm going to help you put it in a way that it's nice and ready to play next time. Now, what people don't think of, and here's where the tip part is, Do something to make that easy for people. Put labels on your baggies. Use trays and inserts that are clear what goes where. One of the pro tips that I've done, especially at public play events, is if you have like bags of resources, leave one resource in each bag, because you're probably not going to use them all during the game, and then everyone knows where they go back in. You can label your bags. You can have, if you've got a box insert, you can have a picture of what goes where. There are all kinds of ways. Even better if the publisher provides a picture of what goes in their trays. But there's all kinds of ways you can do it. I've seen people take plano boxes and put pictures of the components underneath the plastic so that you can clearly see what goes where. I've seen a sheet of paper under the lid. Give people help to help put your game away the way you want it to be put away.
And even for our own games, you're usually the one that breaks down how you want it organized. Mm-hmm. And it, I look at it and it makes sense to me. And I think I'm going to remember it. And I take it all out and I go to put it away. And I'm like, oh, how was that split up? I actually have no idea what goes where. All right. Well, you know, small baggies for small things. Let's see what we can do. So, yeah, labels. One of the big things I think we all agree that can slow down a game night are rules questions or disputes. That's part of why we already suggested checking BGG and the publisher for any rule updates, FAQ, or errata ahead of time. Even with that, though, things come up. And the quickest option in this case can be to make a ruling and play that way until the end of the game.
Yeah.
You take a look at the rules, and if you can't find an answer within a minute or two, you just agree on something that sounds reasonable and you move on. And then you can look up the real solution after the game, perhaps even between game nights, and share it with the group so you can play it correctly next time.
And remember,
you don't want to get bogged down in a, you know, half an hour or 45 minutes of trying to figure out what the errata is on some minute bit of a board game. And we've done this. It's not fun. It ruins the evening.
Yeah. Now, this is something that does get helped out if you can get that pregame in where you play with one other person to kind of learn the game. But remember that your first play of any game will be extreme. So this will come up, especially your first play of any game.
Yeah, and something we do often that becomes a bit of a game in itself is to have everyone try and find that answer at once. Some people on Google, some people on Board Game Geek. Another option is the person who happens to be the most skilled at finding that sort of thing, digging to be the official rule checker. Though usually one person looking in the book and another looking online is a very good middle ground at the very least. Yeah. You know, having someone in the group prepping by already having a PDF version of the rules downloaded can be helped. Doing a Control F on your rule book is a lot faster sometimes than flipping through the way some rule books are organized.
And the next big thing that can slow down a board game night, especially hobby board games, is AP or analysis paralysis. How much of an impact this has and how much you care is going to vary group by group. I know a group of local gamers is willing to give players 5-10 minutes per turn to take their turn and have no problem playing one game over an entire weekend. But then there's other players who just want to get the game moving and get it over with. This is also very game dependent. Of course, heavier games require more thinking and you can expect them to take longer. Where it goes into AP territory, that's going to be up to you and your group. Now, the biggest thing that you can do to help with AP is plan ahead as much as you can for your turn. Now, the thing is, everyone says that part, but what they often skip is the next part, which is accounting for the fact that other players are in the game and things are going to change. So don't set your heart on the one thing you know you're going to do. On my turn, I'm doing this. No, go on my turn, I want to do this, but you know what the other players are doing and you can kind of predict what they're doing. You know how they play. Come up with contingency plans so that you have a couple of different plays planned. So I want to do this, but if that doesn't work because Deanna's going to take that, then I'm going to do this and that's not going to work because Sean's going to move in here, then I'm going to do that. Yes, every now and then people will do the unexpected and you'll be stuck. But in general, this is going to help things speed things up.
Yeah, and it's one thing if you have to think something through before making your turn within a reasonable limit. But it's another if you've spent the last 5 minutes looking at your phone and you're now going, oh, huh, wait, is it my turn? And you've done zero pre-planning.
Yeah.
And you're just starting to figure out what you're going to do. And sometimes it doesn't seem like a lot in that moment, but the accumulation of these AP turns really adds up and adds to your overnight time for your game. And all of a sudden, your overall time for the game, I meant. And all of a sudden, you only fit in one game that night because of it. Yeah. It shouldn't need to be said, but pay attention even when it's not your turn. Assuming you were showing up to a planned game night, people are there to play games. If everyone else at the table is taking things seriously, you have an obligation to do so as well. You leave the distractions behind, you focus on the game. And this is session zero stuff. Just make it clear to folks that you invite, that you expect them to be present and paying attention. Or maybe you want to have a really casual night where y'all are chatting and that's your fun, but just make sure everyone at the table is on the same page.
Yeah. If you're having that social casual game night, you're probably not doing the optimization tips that we're here. You're probably not looking to bang in as many game nights as possible. And that's great. Everyone's got that option. But here tonight, we're looking to really see how many games we can wedge into that limited time span. And so a small thing that can actually make a bigger impact than you expect is if you do have to leave the table, do so just after you've taken your turn. Bio breaks, making an important phone call, grabbing some food, wait until the end of your turn so that everyone else can continue playing while you're gone.
Yeah, one of the most frustrating things to me as a player, I don't get that upset about AP, but if it's like about to be your turn and you get up and leave and then you're like, but that one is a pet peeve of mine. I've got to admit, people who aren't even aware their turn's coming up and they wander away, or that's when they decide to make that phone call. I'm like, you can check your phone. We don't ban phones at the table, but don't check it just before your turn's about to start or when the player to your right is taking their turn. You know, just schedule that a little bit better. Now, Sean did mention food and grabbing some food. We've said this many times in the show. This is probably one of our most repeated tips, and that is eat before or after the game, especially if you're looking at a meal. Snacks are different, but if you're going to sit down and have a meal or even order pizza, pizza is the big one, right? People order pizza or tacos or something in the middle of game night. What I suggest is get everyone together first. Go meet somewhere off-site or have a big meeting in the kitchen and go eat somewhere where you're not playing. And that is when you're going to get in that what's up chat. The I haven't seen you in a couple of weeks. What's going on? How are the kids? How was back to school? Oh, how's the job going? Did you get that promotion? All of that talk is going to come up because game nights are social and people that social interaction. People are going to ask these kind of questions. That's what you do with friends, right? You chit chat and you have sometimes casual talk, sometimes not casual talk. But if you get all that out of the way during dinner or whatever meal break, it won't happen at game night, which is awesome because then you can focus on the game. You can talk about what's going down before the game. You can ask about the kids and so on, all before the gaming starts. Now, the alternative is to do it after, but I find usually if you eat after, you're talking about the games. Oh, I should have done this in turn two. And man, I really enjoyed this game, which honestly is an awesome conversation, fun to have. So I guess the perfect thing is meet for lunch, then game, then go out for dinner together or drinks after. Except now we're just getting into Mo's dream game night and not as much efficiency anymore.
We've thrown efficiency out the window and are creating 12-hour game nights with breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I will say when we started doing this, it does depend on who you're getting together with, but we just had such better nights overall, being able to sit and chat with our friends first and then play games.
Yeah.
If you have the time for it, I highly recommend it. It's a super great way to hang out with the people you enjoy. But figure out the food ahead of time. All that time you save having everything set up and ready to go is going to be wasted as soon as someone asks, so what do you want to have for dinner? And then you spend the next 45 minutes debating whether you're getting Indian or pizza. Like it's...
Yeah, even just not knowing, we always have either pizza or Greek. Well, pick one, because just deciding between pizza and Greek can take a lot more time than you think, depending on all sorts of different things.
Now, plus, if you're getting pizza, talk about toppings ahead of time. We have made that mistake many times. We're like, we're all going to order pizza. And it takes 45 flipping minutes to order because, okay, so you're with them and they're getting the vegetarian and you're with, oh, wait, who else is in on pizza? You know, like for our personal group, every New Year's, every birthday, every big gaming event, when we have more than four of us together, that's a large portion of the night. And we are bad about getting it done ahead of time. We really are. We will establish we're all getting pizza and everyone has to bring $12 to chip in or whatever, but knowing what we're going to get on that pizza, it takes up far too much of the night.
Yeah, we got to walk in there with here's a check mark. Put your name under one of these three pizzas.
Yeah, that's a good idea, actually.
Actually, that's terribly efficient, Sean. I may use that.
Hey, you know what? Have a menu for your food.
All right. Well, while it doesn't have much to do with game night efficiency, keep the food and drinks separate from the games. Side tables at a bare minimum. Only eating in another area, even better. Only eating before or after games, best. Because let's just ask people, what happens when drinks are on the table with the games?
Yes, we had some recent experience with this one. And we know better. That's the worst part, is we know better. You get lazy, you get complacent. Like, when's the last time we our copy of Robot Quest Arena, which is behind me right there, is now Robot Quest Arena Aqua Edition with some water warped cards in it now due to a spill of, thankfully, just a glass of water, but still a spill. At the bare minimum, actually, coasters, especially coasters with lips. There, we'll hold it up. This coasters with lips at least would help, but that wouldn't have stopped this problem. Should have had it on another table. I'm usually pretty good about it, but I got lazy, left a glass on a table, and I talk with my hands. You have no idea watching this podcast how hard it is for me not to have my hands in frame. So we have learned this one many times and still make the mistake. We are getting better.
Well, I have another one for tabletop setup. So we've talked before about bowls and using wooden salad bowls to hold components. This is actually something that does speed up gameplay. If I don't have to have one person playing the bank and we can pass bowls around, or we can have the bank split into splitting things, having the bank for the game into some on this end, some on that end, where everyone can reach their own components and I don't have to be interrupting your turn or your thought process in between your turn for you to hand me stuff. Having multiple copies of, for Hamburg, for existence, for example, is one that really hits this one. Having multiple copies of the rulebook available for people to consult in the middle of the game. All of those things really can help with the game playing quicker and smoother.
You want to double your play time on Terraforming Mars, split that deck in half. Even better, four. Put it one at all, each corner of the board. It's a huge deck with all the expansions. You have no idea how much quicker the game will be played by just not going, okay, I take three. Okay, how many do you want? Okay, I'm taking these. Have multiple discard piles. Split resources. You got a pile of money. Split it up. Even Monopoly money. If I ever played Monopoly again, I would split that bank in two. There'd be the money on one half of the board and half the money on the other half of the board.
And it's like the AP accumulation. It feels like a little bit of time, but it's a little chunk of time, that adds up over the night to be a giant chunk of time and cuts into your playing.
And know your game. So this is something that's not going to happen on your first game. Might not even happen on your second or third game. But as you get used to a game, we're going to be talking about Eclipse, the Second Dawn of the Galaxy, later tonight. Mm-hmm. And there are certain actions which don't interfere with other players. And when those actions are being chosen, the next player can jump ahead and start doing their turn. And maybe even the next player can jump ahead and start doing their turn. Know the game and know when and where you are able to overlap. You do not have to necessarily wait for someone to finish their turn completely if what they're doing doesn't impact anybody else's actions on the board. You can get a whole lot of extra time that way.
No, that's a great one. And to go with that, when picking games, look for games with simultaneous action selection where players can do this. Certain games are designed for this. Fantastic Factories, one of the reasons it's such a fast game is, yes, you spend a round going around the table drafting cards, but then everyone does their dice and runs their engine and building on their own. Any game where you can all take turns simultaneously is great for that. A lot of flipping rights, rolling rights, random rights, whatever you want to call them, are also good for that, where you put one card up and everyone does their own thing.
One of Dee's favorite genres of games, of course, is the real-time game where you're just going at it, everyone reaching in there all at once. Fireworks is one of our most recent examples where you're playing against the sand timers right there on the game. So if you really want to know your game time, games like that will help.
Yeah, there you go. So it's Skyrockets. No,
Skyrockets, yes, there we go.
Skyrockets. Oh, even better, grab a game like Fuse or Breakdancing Meeples that has a timer, and you will know exactly how long your game will be.
You do not have to do this. You do not have to do this.
Is there a timer in Rail Pass? I know it's real. I know it. Yeah.
There's a timer in Rail Pass. Yep. All right. That's what I had down. Do either of you have anything else you want to add? Is there anything else before we jump to the lobby, which I got to say, good job, lobby. If you have anything else to add, toss it in there right now.
All right. Looking at the lobby, we had a few people in there jumping ahead of us and just sort of nailing our topics before we even got to them. You can tell who the real fans of the show are because they know what we're going to come up with Ryan saying solo play is now your friend. Absolutely. If you want to learn a game, those solo play rules are a big help. Although do be aware that there are often some variations in there that may not play out the same way as you are with a group.
Now, what I think Ryan's actually calling out there is if you want more time to game, play solo, because then you don't need other people and there's no scheduling issues or conflicts, or you don't have to worry about meeting for meals ahead of time. You can eat whenever the heck you want because it's your game. So I think he was leaning more that way is the way I read it.
Fair enough. So encourage everyone again to grab the PDF rules and read ahead if able. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Hop on Board Game Geek. Just make sure that if you're telling other people to do that, that your paper rules match the Board Game Geek PDF rules. You don't want to be reading version 1.0 in your box when everyone else is reading version 1.2 on the website.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
And that's also why we suggested find the best sources and send them. Don't just tell people watch a YouTube video. YouTube content creators who create how to plays are not all created equal. Some go into more detail than others. Others focus on other things and some get the rules wrong. So when you do watch one of those, make sure you check the comments to see if anyone's pointed out mistakes. But as the game teacher, the one, you know, the one hosting the event, do your due diligence by finding the best one and sending them links. Don't just say, go watch a video. Say, hey, go watch Paul Grogan, how to play this, or go watch Rodney Smith, or go watch this, or check out Rado, or here's the best one I found. Now, a good way to do that is on Board Game Geek. If you go to the video section, you will find the top rated review and the top rated how to play by Board Game Geek users. That's a great place to start. Now, they're not perfect, but at least there's some sorting already done there for you. So you're not just going to Google and saying how to play Sea of Blood. The top of the Google list is often people who are good at SEO who aren't not necessarily good at teaching games.
And I think Victor had a really good idea. A photo of the packed game in the box would be handy. That's something maybe we should try for our public play events.
We've got Darkling Blight jumping in there and getting ahead of us with when you're setting up your big game, set up ahead of time or organize in your own containers. And if ordering food, plan ahead or keep it simple. That charcuterie board that everyone's going to pick from. Maybe if you know that everyone will eat off of it, you can prepare that in advance. Yeah. And you don't need to worry about any of the discussions.
And yes, Charlie Brown, spending 10 minutes to decide what to do in Shadow Ninjas is unacceptable.
Yes.
All right. Major Kayla twitching at the idea of us table wiping into a box. Charlie Brown asking if we're allowed to make mistakes the first time we play. Never.
Of course. You're allowed to do whatever you want with your games. No, the main point of that law, why we pointed out, is more of a warning of double check the rules. Like, it's shocking how many times I will play a game and then sit down at a public play event with someone else and be like, wait, that's not how I play this game. One of the more famous examples is the game Raw. It is an auction game that I had probably played 50 times. They put out a Raw app. This is years ago. This is back in university days and the University of Windsor Game Club days. And I grabbed the app and I played it and went, well, what just happened? Why? I can't remember what it was. It had to do with what tiles are wiped during a flood. That's all I remember. I don't remember if it was I was wiping too many or I was wiping things that shouldn't have been, but it was enough that it changed the entire game. And then the Bellhop's unofficial rule is, well, you know what? It was better by the actual rules because, you know what? Games are actually, rules are there for a reason. The game actually played better when you followed the rules. And no, that's not always the case. There's a couple things we played extreme that in the end went, you know, I kind of like the extreme version. Let's stick with that. But most of the time, the playtested, well-playtested, especially, you know, something like Raw that's been around for a very long time and is a crowd favorite over the years. It's pretty good if you play it by the right rules. Who knew?
Beyond Dead's mentioning back to the food. Sweating glasses drip onto cards. Yes, they do.
Oh, God, yeah.
Coasters are the reason why we are how we prevent sweating glasses.
That is particularly bad when you're out at a brewery. There's one brewery we like to go to that does not have coasters or only has them sometimes if you ask for them. And it makes trying to play card games.
Yeah, we have a Star Realms card that unfortunately was a casualty of melding with the table due to condensation we didn't even realize was there.
Exactly. You just don't even notice it's happening, right?
Went to pick up the card and it was just, nope.
Yeah, and I mean, we could solve this problem by sleeving, but we don't sleeve. We're dangerous that way.
And to be fair, with sleeving, what happened to my copy of Robot Quest ran, I don't think sleeves would have helped all that much.
No.
It might have saved one or two cards, but like this water just would have went in the sleeve. I would have had to double sleeve back and forth, you know, all that stuff. Are we good with the chat? I think that covers most of the good ones.
Yep. No, I think so.
I hope we're able to give you some ideas for getting the more out of your game nights, getting more games played, more focus on the games, getting more done in the same amount of time or more done in a shorter amount of time. Time's short, and it seems like there's never enough of it. So I hope this at least helps you get more out of the time you do have. Even if you just learned one tip tonight that will work for you, I'm happy.
And what did we miss? What is something you do to keep your game nights slim and trim? What's a tip you use to get the most out of every session? Let us know by leaving a comment wherever you watched or heard this. Email me at Deanna@tabletopbellhop.com. Hit us up on social media or post something on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
And now a shout out for our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
The Grand Gamers Guild is going to Germany. You can see them at Essen Spiel booth 3-H313. That's 3-H313. If you stop by, be sure to tell them that the Tabletop Bellhop sent you.
Well, they're going to have a number of their hot new games available at Essen. The big one we think everyone is going to be excited about is Endeavor Deep Sea.
So we love the original Endeavor Age of Sail, and we went all in on the Kickstarter for it in 2017. It's a fantastic game that plays great, but one that features a rather problematic colonial theme.
So not only has this follow-up removed all of that, with a new theme about exploring and making the biggest positive impact on the planet's vast interconnected ocean space, they've also taken every possible effort to make the game as green as possible.
There are no plastic components in the game, which is pretty cool. Even the game trays are made out of bagasse, which is a byproduct of sugarcane processing.
We'll get a good look at Endeavor Deep Sea at booth 3-H313 at Essen and pick it up right from the con, but supplies will be very limited.
Or if you're like us and not making it overseas this year, you can pre-order the deluxe version of the game direct from Grand Gamers Guild, where you can use our exclusive code Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to save 10%.
You can find a link in our show notes.
Let's start off by announcing the winners for our 2 6th anniversary giveaways.
So first off was our Tirnanog reprint and expansion giveaway. That went to Gabby J, who's already confirmed their entry. And we put in touch with Mark from Grand Gamers Guild, who we have to thank again for supplying this prize.
And the next one was a giveaway for one of our 6 best new to us games that we discovered in the last year. Jeez, that's a mouthful. The winner, Jeffrey B., chose to get a copy of the Artemis Project, and I hope they enjoy the game as much as we do.
Congratulations to both of our winners, but we're not done yet.
We also have a new merch store set up. So the one that I have currently in place just isn't working for us for many reasons. And by setting up this new one, I have more control over it, and we were able to have some way cooler products and to get all the new designs that our daughter Gwendolyn did for the Inspired By games in there and onto mugs and shirts and stuff. So it is looking pretty cool. It's I'd say it's 98.9% set up. There's a couple tweaks still to be made, but I figure I will give you guys a preview and drop the link and you can go take a look at it.
Yeah, so we did drop the link in the chat room. I'll be sure to also include it in the show notes, but I think a lot of people already know the site Fourth Wall. It's what a lot of content creators and streamers are now using. If you just go to Fourth Wall and search Tabletop Bellhop, you should be able to find us.
I haven't put the new redirect into place, but by the time this podcast drops on Tuesday, you should just be able to go to tabletopbellhop.com/merch, and okay, you will end up at the new store.
Okay, perfect. I didn't know if we'd have that yet.
And now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
With back to school, Sean moving again, Labor Day weekend and more, it's been a slow couple of weeks for getting games to the table. We've only got 4 to talk about, 2 of which are totally new to us. So let's start with those. Both of these come from Envy Born Games, who you're going to recognize from our coverage of Mind Your Business. We've gotten to know the fine folks at this company a bit better over the last year, actually meeting up with them at Gamma Expo originally, and then at Origins after initially meeting them last year at Origins. They seem like great folk. They make cool games. They're very passionate about their games, and they're trying to do some cool stuff with like fanny packs that hold games and stuff like that. They've grown a lot since Mind Your Business and seem like their games are a little more polished now. Now, their big push this year is their series of small box games that are all 18 card games. So they're following that, you know, that 18 card challenge where Love Letter spawned out of, and putting out these small box games. And while we tried two of them since we were last here.
So first up is Sirens. Now, I saw the prototype for this game at Origins back in 2023, and like I was hooked as soon as I saw it. I have a soft spot for things with a classical Civ theme, and the art style in this game plays off of the style of figures that you find on Grecian urns. So that really kind of drew me, right? When I first open up our copy, I'm flipping through the cards, and I just find this game aesthetically pleasing. Like, the overall look and the artwork appeals to me. Out of the entire set of cards, there's one card I was met on, their version of Kyribus, which they show as a whirlpool with teeth. It just didn't seem to match with the rest of the art, but it's not awful. It just kind of felt like one of these kids is doing his own thing compared to the other cards. But like overall, just from a physical standpoint, the visual style of this game, I find totally compelling. And then there's that whole thing where you're composing a piece of music as you build your six cards together. And when you're done, you can actually make it play on an app. And it's not like phenomenal. It does have a sort of like it's been played on a lyre kind of sound. Like it's not playing synth rock or something completely. it doesn't sound like it was done by Mario on the NES, right? Like Mo said, he thought it was a little digital, but I thought it actually sounded kind of neat. And there's something in the game where you get into a flow state, and when you appropriately make the music flow, it does sound better. When you play them in pieces that don't flow, it's a little more jarring. So all of that I found kind of neat.
Yeah, the gameplay is pretty simple. It's a drafting game. So you're going to get a hand of cards. You're going to pick one to play, and then you're going to pass the cards to your opponent. You're going to get your opponent's card, pick one to keep, pass to your opponent, and that way you're going to get three cards. Then you do it again for another set of three cards, and you're going to get points. Like Deanna said, the flow, there's four different colors in the game, and there's like a rock, paper, scissors thing. And I'm going to get the names wrong, but like a green follows red, which follows blue, which follows yellow, and you get points for doing that. And your song has to have three different sections in it. So you have to have three different colors. And then there's some symbols on the card. And if you match them up, you get bonus points. It's a simple game, but it flows really well. It makes sense. And it does have a unique theme. And like I said, it's one of our long-term fans of the show, Danielle, had one time ago asked about games where you make music. Well, here is one. You literally create music while playing this game.
Which is so neat, right? It's there's a solo play mode, and it is wickedly hard. You are playing as a siren who is trying to stop Orpheus from entering the underworld. And the game lures you in, because if you play at the normal difficulty, round one is ridiculously easy. Like, it's rigged towards you winning. And then round two is like infinitely 10x more difficult. You need to win two times to win the game. And winning two rounds against Orpheus is hard. You have perfect knowledge. You draw two cards and you choose which one to keep and which one to give to Orpheus. And you play until your song has six cards in it, but Orpheus's song gets seven. Your song has to have at least three parts in it to score, but Orpheus's can have any number of parts and still score. And then once you've won once, Orpheus apparently starts to take the challenge more seriously, or he gets cranky or something. All of his hearts are doubled. Parts show up on some cards and they're scored at the end of the game. And then each single part of Orpheus's song gets a bonus. So his single cards are now worth four instead of one. And it's hard. And it becomes this enticing puzzle to try and figure out how to not just make a decent song for yourself, but also to simultaneously ensure that Orpheus's song sucks. So.
Now, one thing I do want to mention is the app is free, which the only reason I'm calling this out is there are other content creators who have talked about this game, and their main complaint about it was that they had to pay for the app. So I don't know what happened, if it used to cost money or it doesn't, or maybe it's not free on Apple, but it is on Android. I'm not sure what it is, but at this point, if you pick up this game, the app is 100% free. We never paid anything for it. We both downloaded it, and we were both able to use it. Now, the next new to us game, also from Envy Born Games, is Confusing Lands. This is actually the newest game in their small box series. It's 18 double-sided cards that are kind of like the cards in Hokkaido or Honshu, if you know that game, or Circle the Wagons. You've got a 2x3 grid showing various icons and landscapes on them. And when you play a card, you have to overlap one or more existing cards in your tableau. Now, the neat bit here that I really liked is there's something like Point Salad in this. Every single card has a scoring opportunity on one side and just lands on the other. Now, the scoring opportunity sides also have land, so you're still playing them into your tableau. You're going to draw two cards, each of you. You're going to play one either side up and then pass the other to your opponent. So similar to Sirens, there's that other hand drafting system. Now, the trick to the scoring is every time you have a face-up scoring card, you lose 10 points. So you have to make sure they're worth at least 11 points or more, or you've wasted that card. And I've got to say, the first time I taught it, I skipped that, which I probably shouldn't have.
Yeah, it was mean not to mention to me, oh, by the way, every scoring card you have in play is giving me minus 10 points. Oh, geez, I wonder why you won so much that first game. Maybe
I don't think I did win the first game, actually.
No, I'm pretty sure you did by a lot. Yeah. I think I was like negative 40 or something ridiculous. And he wrote, I dig this game. It is full of interesting choices, which card to play on which side, what to cover up as you place more cards, all of that. I love how small and portable the game is. This is a great purse game for pulling out when you're at a pub or a coffee shop. It takes a fair amount of table space, but it's doable on a small bar table. So, yeah.
And next up, we had an epic 5-player game of Eclipse, Second Dawn for the Galaxy. Now, this was one of my last dinners at Brenda's that I was able to get to. So we had a big old family game of Eclipse, and this game just still hits all those sci-fi spots. Yeah. It there's so much good about that game, between the variety of asymmetric or symmetric options for your characters, whether you want to play humans or aliens. And all the setup, the way the Second Dawn for the Galaxy box, the inserts where you can just hand someone, here's your color, go ahead and play, go to it. It's all right there for you. It's easy to set up. They even have the option to flip your scoring tracks over depending on which way you want to look at it, although that turned out to be a little trickier than we thought it was. The option is there once you figure out how to do it. Again, just for a 4X game, it is just so straightforward, and I know I'm biased because I like sci-fi games, but for all the complexity of that game, it just plays so smoothly because everything fits into the theme so nicely.
And this was one of those games that was nice because everyone who sat down to play had played the game before. And for some of us, it wasn't that long ago, Father's Day, mm-hmm. which I realize isn't that close together, but for big epic games, you know, twice in one quarter, I guess we're over two quarters, but twice in a 3-month period is pretty frequent for these kind of games. And it was nice to be able to just kind of sit down, quick rule refresher, and get going. And I've got to say props to Ludapout for including player aids that pretty much walk you through everything. And I remember I was flipping through the rule book and Sean's like, so it's like this? Yeah, it's on this card. Oh, so it's like this? Yeah, it's on this card. It's like this? Yeah, that's on the card too. And you can pretty much, if you know the game at all, be able to play just from the reference cards, which is really nice. What was fun about this one is, despite being a huge fan of the game and having Second Dawn for a while, I still hadn't explored all of the content. So we tossed in some of the optional stuff that used to be promos that were available for Eclipse that were included in this edition. And I think every single promo galaxy came up in that game, even though we randomly generated them. So we got to deal with an exploding pulsar that you had to roll for every turn to see if it explodes. Nebulas that had multiple places to land inside a single galaxy. Two different black holes that you could send your ships through. And we had a lot of the new technology come up for the first time ever. I had someone build, and I forget what it is, but the space rift cannon or something like that, which has its own special die. And we got to see just how dangerous that was, because that would be how Brenda blew up her own fleet at the end of the game instead of, you know, finally taking over some territory. So it's a game that just keeps giving. It is one of my favorite games of all time. Honestly, it's up there. It might even surpass Anachrony because we're playing it more often than Anachrony. And well, you know, our second law is the game that gets to the table is the best game. And I got to say, out of Anachrony and Second Dawn, I'm playing Second Dawn a little more than I'm playing Anachrony. So that could just mean we need to get Anachrony to the table.
Yeah, the black hole cards. So there's, I don't know, it's a mixed blessing there. So I managed to draw two of those, three of those. I had three of the one with three sectors, And then I had the two black hole cards.
And the Pulsar.
I think my mom had the Pulsar. Or maybe I also had the Pulsar.
The Pulsar was the one you had to keep rolling every turn based on the number of
times. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. But at least that one gave me something. The rest of them, I'm like, you can get an alien artifact off of it, but they don't, they're not worth any points. And when you're doing your random exploring, to have not one, not two, but three different galaxies that are not going to grant you any points is just kind of, eh, you know, well, I'm like, fair, it was kind of cool and not all at once.
To be fair, Sean got no galaxies.
Yeah, I got nothing that I needed resource wise on any of my galaxies. There's definitely, you know, there's an element of randomness to this game, which definitely impacts the winner of the game, or at least the winner, depending on how set you are for a strategy. Because I had chosen a non-aggressive race who actually would suffer if I went too aggressive, you know, I had planned on one thing, and unfortunately I didn't get the resources I needed to take that path early enough.
I thought
you
came in
second, so you can't really complain.
Sean won.
Oh, you won. Sorry, you won.
Did I win?
He won by a large amount.
No, Mo won. I won the first time.
I won that game by a huge amount.
No, you can go look it up. I swear Sean won.
I did look it up. Mo won.
Yes.
Oh,
well, I'm like, I destroyed. Sean came in second.
Yeah, I came in second.
I'm not paying enough attention.
36-35. It was close. Like, you 36-35, and then you had 30th in third.
Yeah, okay. My point was, at one point, you were like, I'm going to be knocked out of this game. I don't even think I'm going to be able to play.
Oh, yeah, no, I literally was. Choices. I literally had to, like, hand in most of my...
We talked it out, and we're like, you're going to need to build orbitals, because orbitals will let you get currency. And then once you have currency, you can do this. And I was able to help Brenda, too, because she got cut off by the other players. And I'm like, you have to be aggressive. There's nothing else you can do. This is going to be your end score if you don't move out of where you are.
But my point was, Sean went in the hole and went impressively in the hole and still pulled off a victory within one point of you.
Yes.
That I would not have predicted at that point in the game. I actually felt bad for Sean. I was like, oh. Yeah.
I was one turn away from elimination from the game. We didn't even realize until that point that there is the potential for player elimination in Eclipse.
It'd be pretty rough.
I kind of knew.
It'd be pretty hard. Because just taking back influence tokens, you're probably going to be left with your home world at least. You can probably afford that 3 credits that I think the first spot is.
And what's interesting about the game is that, well, it rewards people coming in attacking each other. It only rewards it up to a point. Mm-hmm. Like going all in full hog, just military. I mean, once you've got your 4s or your 3s over there, there might be better things to do, which means that it's unlikely someone's going to completely aggressively eliminate you because they probably have better things to do with their life.
Well, there's also that interesting... You still get points for taking over the spots, right? So sometimes it's worth it, but then you run out of influence chips.
Yeah, well,
this game I played super aggressive. The race I had gave me a bonus in combat, and I went all combat, and I'd never done that in Eclipse, and it was quite fun.
Yeah, I was noticing where somebody attacked me at the end game, and that actually gained me like 6 points or something like that because of the way things went out and the token I pulled out of the bag. So, you know, aggression has the good and bad, depending on how you play.
Yeah. It's got that side thing, right? You want to do at least some fighting to get those you had a fight tokens.
Yeah, no. And I think that just makes it super balanced. Yeah. It's why I love it. And then the other thing was that this was like, what, 4.5-5 hours, even with all of us knowing it.
Yeah, it is not a short game.
No.
It's a 4X.
It's no Twilight Imperium, but it still can be long.
We went into it thinking it was going to be shorter because we had played recently and we all knew the rules, but that was not true.
No.
And we were optimizing our turns. I mean, we had, you know, 3 people playing turns at the same time because those 2 people were doing things that didn't affect out someone else.
Mm-hmm.
All right, moving on. Last gameplay. Stefan Fels Hamburg. Been talking about this one a lot, and we're kind of deep diving it because we played the base game enough. It's good. It's Bruges. It's fantastic. I now like the fact I get to pick my colors. I'm over the randomness that was removed from Bruges. But what we haven't done is any of the optional content, and there's a lot. I think it's like 10 modules. I might be off. And I will admit I was very tempted to toss them all in at once, but that doesn't really let us tell what impact each individual one does. So we picked 2 optional modules. We use the mares, which adds asymmetry to the game, and the ships. And the main reason the one I really wanted to try was the ships, because I guess that was something that was in the expansion box for Bruges. And the much sought after expansion box for Bruges that everyone was like, this is must have, but it's out of print. You can't get it. And you can only order it from France and whatever the heck was going on with that. Well, that's part of this game. So starting off with the mares, simple. There's 5 double-sided mare tiles. Each features a different actual historic mayor of Hamburg. You shuffle them out, give them out to the players, and they pick which side to use. Each sets your starting money and the number of people you get, and then gives you an in-game power. Now, the interesting thing is that's all positive. There was no downside to this. And I almost all the mayors, there's one that starts with no people, but they get a ton of money. Most of the mayors start off with more than you got when you played the base game. So it's weird. It was like they created this module as a here to get you started. Here's a bit of engine at the beginning. Here's some direction. They just made every character, every player more powerful, which obviously led to a higher scoring game, like by a significant amount.
But it felt balanced. Like we had more to start with in an even sort of fashion. And I did like, first off, I liked that first choice of looking at each side and going, oh, am I going to do A or B? I like having some direction that's kind of an idea of where I want to go in the game, right? And, you know, between that, and it gives you something to aim for. So I liked the mirrors, and I would play with them going forward.
And I wouldn't put them in the first play. Like, this is something I think you should leave in the box until you know the game. Because that first decision on what power do I want, if you don't know the game, you're going to be like, what's this do? How powerful is that? How good is that?
That would be far too much for someone that doesn't know the game. Yes. That would break it right there. You'd be spending 15 minutes trying to figure out what the heck.
Now, I will admit, just to stick with the trend of Hamburg, we did have to grab the addendum to be able to look up what each of these mayors' powers were. Because the
iconography. We did it right this time, though. We had an iPad and the rule book and the cell phone.
I got to admit, the more we play, I'm finally getting mastery of the icons. I've now figured out the difference for when it's showing the draw deck and the discard deck. There is actually a difference in the icon. I can now tell that apart. More often when I look up an icon, I get it right this time. Next was the boats, which this to me felt like a very significant impact on play. There's one boat for each of the dice in the game, including black. So usually the black die doesn't affect a lot of stuff. There is a black boat as well. The boats become active whenever a die comes up with a 3 or 4, which means now when you roll the dice, every die does something. Because they're either going to mean you can go up on the middle track, or they're going to mean you have a disaster, or it's going to move a boat. So every die roll now matters. Then during your turn, if you build a wall, note you have to build a wall. After doing the build a wall action, paying all the costs you normally would, you can then spend a worker of the color of the wall you built to activate any boat that's active, that's ready for that round, that there was a 3 or 4. Each boat gives a pretty powerful bonus. Like some extra money, because money's tight in this game. The biggest one I saw was reactivate one of your instant buildings, the building that had an effect when you play it. You now have a way to reactivate those. So that makes those buildings way more powerful if that boat comes up. Taking 3 workers, going up on the town hall track for only $3, and so on. Each boat's different. I'm not going to get into all the boats. This isn't meant to be a review.
What I thought was interesting about it is that the boats give you a bonus specifically for building sections of your wall, which incentivizes people to build the wall. And I thought everyone, I mean, I went for it that game. I was like, all the wall. And Gwen also did quite a bit of wall, but you and my mom did barely any wall at all. And I was surprised by that because I felt like this was pushing you to build wall pieces to get this bonus section. Of course, I didn't win, so I wasn't doing it right.
Well, you know why I didn't do it. I had a combo in my starting hand that worked particularly well, that actually won me the game. I had a very powerful 12-cost card, and I had a very powerful mirror ability that let me activate a building twice. So every round, I could activate this 12-cost building twice. And then partway through the game, I got another building that generated points and money that I could now activate twice instead. And with both of those, I didn't have to worry about the walls.
Maybe the mirrors do break the game.
I don't know. It definitely led me to a different strategy. I will say that much. But yes, there were definitely more walls. There were more statues. I have never seen so many statues built in a game of Hamburg. I think we went through 4 of them. Like the final statue at the end of the game was only worth 4 points. So that was interesting to say. I don't know. It was just different. Like, people did play different. I honestly think your mom probably should have built more walls, and probably just that was a bit another level that she'd have to think about that she just ignored. It's kind of what I felt like with that was just that's something I don't even want to have to worry about. Then I'd have to learn all with all these boats do too. I don't know. So far, I'm digging it. Next, I'll probably toss in the new statues, because all that does is when you do complete a wall, you get to choose if you want points or money.
Yeah.
And that doesn't seem like it would break anything. And I think I'll throw in the extra disaster tiles, which means you could have two go up instead of one, which I got to say, the disasters had way more of an impact on this game than previous games we played. They were relentless this game.
Boats with statues would be pretty interesting because, again, there's an incentive to build walls, and then you get more choices with your statues. Yes. Those two things together, will be super fun.
Yeah. Those are the two I want to put in. The big one is the stock market thing, where different actions in the game will have different value. Yeah. I have no idea on that one still. I'm leery of that one.
I am. I don't know. Just on paper, I'm not keen on it, but we got to try it out.
But what it's supposed to do is make it so that some of the lesser taken actions are more attractive at certain points in the game, right? So you're like, well, normally I wouldn't take workers, but if I take workers right now, I get doubled or whatever. And that's supposedly what it's supposed to do, as well as devaluing. There'll be a point in the game where walls are going to cost three times more and no one's going to build them, right? Mm-hmm. So it looks interesting. That's it for what we've been playing.
Oh, you know the other thing about that particular game of Hamburg? Random things are random. I cannot believe that we went through a game where for half of the game we could not go up the city steps. And that hadn't come out in our previous plays, you know.
Yeah, literally half the game we did not roll a one or two on any of the dice. And that's a dice game. It happens.
Yep.
So, yes, that one was frustrating for me because I was one step away from taking that majority. But I ended up winning anyway, so.
Build a coalition and become the king's head advisor in the card drafting game King's Coalition from new publisher Play to Zed Games.
Play to Z is a new company founded by Zev Slashinger, the man behind Z-Man Games, along with a host of industry professionals. Now, we've got to thank Zev himself for hooking us up with an advanced review copy of this one, and it is their first published game.
King's Coalition was designed by Derek Croxton and features artwork from Rod Rodriguez. It plays 2 to 5 players and includes 2 modes of play, a regular version and an advanced version. Even the advanced version plays in about half an hour.
The goal of King's Coalition is to draft the best hand of cards by the end of the round, six rounds. Each turn, you will recruit a new card and dismiss a card from your hand. The trick here is that how the cards will score changes each game.
Physically, King's Coalition comes in a small box, which includes the rules, a scoring pad, a first player marker, and 4 bonus point tokens, and cards in 2 sizes. There's the main deck, which is standard size cards that featured number cards from 8 different suits, with the numbers ranging from 0 to 12. The second deck are more larger cards, tarot size cards, that are used for randomizing the game's scoring opportunities. Card quality here is excellent, the iconography is very clear. Card abilities are listed right on the cards, as well as being provided on a small reference card.
Like many traditional card games, setting up King's Coalition is quick. You shuffle the main deck and deal everyone 7 cards. You then place 6 cards face down on the table. 4 random scoring cards are dealt, and a scoring token is assigned to each of them.
Every game of King's Coalition starts with 2 scoring cards in play that never change. The first awards points for sets of 3 or more cards from the same suit. The second awards points for numbered straights of 6 or more. In addition to this, every player will score the total of the cards in their hands.
At the start of each round, the start player flips the leftmost face-down card and adds it to the middle of the table, which is called the recruitment area. They also flip over the leftmost scoring card if any are still face-down. For the first 4 rounds, a new way to score bonus points is revealed. These are scored in addition to the 3 standard ways to score Sean just mentioned.
Next up, in turn order, players recruit 1 card and then dismiss 1 card. You can recruit from the recruitment area or from the top of the deck. Dismissals come from your hand, and dismissed cards get placed into the recruitment area to be potentially recruited by other players.
Now, once everyone has recruited and dismissed a card, a start player passes to the left and a new round begins. The game ends after 6 rounds after the last face-down card is revealed. At that point, players total their points, and the player with the highest total wins.
That all sounds rather simple, but things get interesting because the cards and numbers are not evenly distributed. There are more peasants in the deck than anything else, and peasants are all numbered either 1 or 2. There are only 3-7 cards in the entire deck, and so on. The included reference card shows this distribution and will be useful to reference while playing.
Then there's the fact that some cards have special abilities. In the basic game, you only use the abilities for peasants and ministers. Peasants may be enlisted, where you recruit one from the recruitment area instead of adding a peasant to your hand. You instead add it to a tableau in front of you. And when you enlist a peasant, you don't dismiss a card, which effectively increases your hand size.
Each of the 5 ministers does something special, and they range from 0 to 7 in value. Each of them has an ability to count as a different card when scoring sets or sequences.
Now, when playing with the advanced rules, every card suit does something special. Apprentices can be enlisted like peasants, but only if you have an apprentice in your hand. Knights can promote other cards to knights. Merchants are worth extra points when part of a sequence, and so on.
We suggest playing a couple of games with the basic rules before adding in any of the advanced rules. The advanced rules are actually really simple once you get going, but I highly recommend a round with just the basic rules whenever you're introducing new players to the game.
Now, finally, the rulebook offers up a method for tournament play where you play 4 games in a row and total your score. For the card counters out there, you can even play with a different set of bonus scoring cards each game, meaning that you will get to see all 16 of them by the time the end of your 4 games.
Now, Deanna and I both got to see King's Coalition when it was just a prototype at Gamma Expo earlier this year. At that point, I watched Zev teach a couple of gamers to play, but didn't myself, but I was intrigued. It looked interesting, and they seemed to be having fun. Then at Origins, both of us, Deanna and I, got a chance to actually sit down and play the game, and we were instantly hooked. Hooked enough that we asked Zev if we could take home a copy, and he agreed, as long as we waited until early September to review it, and well, here you are. Thanks, Zev.
One thing I think that's really important to note is that the game isn't hard to learn or play. With the text on the cards and on the reference cards, with all the special abilities in the game, can feel daunting, but it's really not. So long as you play a couple of basic rounds first, when you do introduce those advanced rules, it just flows naturally and nothing becomes overwhelming. You're left wondering why you were so worried.
Yeah, exactly that. The advanced rules flow. They just make sense once you've got the basics down.
Yeah, I agree. The simplicity of this game is what drew me to it in the first place. I love how simple it is to teach, how quick it was to pick up, and how clever the game in-game interactions are. Like, honestly, the basic mechanics are kind of a Racco level of simple, right? You're going to take a card and then discard a card trying to make the best set of cards. It's the card distribution and the ever-changing bonus scoring opportunities that make it so interesting and engaging.
I love the way you have to adapt during the first few rounds as those scoring cards get flipped up one at a time. And then I like how you have a few rounds at the end to try and get everything in order before you're done.
Yeah, it's really interesting as those available cards and new scoring opportunities arriving slowly throughout the game really shift your plan so that your initial and final plans may be wildly different.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, there's something about King's Coalition. Just, I don't know, feels well-balanced and well-play-tested. Like, Play-Dizzy did their work, or they picked a good game to hire that had some work behind it. I don't know what it is. When deciding what to take early in the round might be simple. You're like, well, I'm going to go for a set. I need a 6, and I'll have a full set. I might as well grab that. But then once those other bonus scoring cards come up that can be worth a significant amount of points, you're going to get to a point where you're going to have to go, am I going to go for that? Or am I going to go for that? Or am I going to try to score these 2, which is worth 5 more points? And then sometimes you can do that, but most of the time you've got to push your luck, hoping for the right card to come up. And having that reference card on hand can really help with that.
Yeah, the reference cards for this game are super useful. Like, there are 8 different card types, and each has its own range of numbers, right? So, for example, the peasants are all 1s and 2s. Well, the gentry comes in 3s, 4s, and 5s. And if you're waiting for a 6 in the gentry, it's not going to be coming up.
Right.
Looking at the reference card can stop you from waiting for a card that is either rare or simply doesn't exist. Knowing you can't possibly get a 3 while sticking to the card types you're trying to aim for is helpful.
Yeah, and when you're ready to move to the advanced rules, the reference cards are a great boon there, too, Just don't let them scare you.
Yeah, the card text on the cards themselves is very clear. And I've got to say, for anyone new to the game, ignore as much as possible of the advanced rules. They're presented different. They're in black. They say advanced rules. Don't even read them. Don't look at them. They're just going to scare you. They're going to confuse you and overwhelm you. But once you play at least one game with the basic rules first, and you've got down, once you've got it down and kind of see how the game plays, all of those advanced rules are just going to make sense. They're going to make perfect sense. You're going to read it and go, oh, I understand why I might want to do this. Oh, I know why knights promote, because I'm going to want to get these bonuses. You don't want to worry about that stuff your first play. That's just going to overwhelm people. The game's not that hard. There is, we talk about onboarding in board games. This game has awesome onboarding. Start with the basic rules, then move on to the advance. Because by the time you play the advance, it honestly makes perfect sense.
Yeah, I think my favorite part of King's Coalition is the fact that the cards you dismiss go into a pool and can be taken by other players. I love that feeling of wanting to help yourself, but also not wanting to help out your opponents too much. And sometimes it's easy to know what to discard, but I relish those times when it's a hard choice. Like, do I toss away a high-numbered card to complete a set or a series, or do I keep it for face value points? Because some of those nobles, they go up to 12, and you do get points for the face value, right? Or do I give that to a player who's enlisting peasants every... Do I give a peasant to a player that's been enlisting peasants every turn? Or do I break up a potential set so I can discard something else? Like, those are all choices that you have to make, and I enjoy that.
And so far, I've yet to see this game fail. We played it with the kids. We played with seniors at the table. We played with family. We played with gamers at local public play events. Every time, it's gone over well, with most people asking to play a second time after the first round. And I got to say, some tables asking for more after that. We've had someone at one of our Walkerville Brewery events that just kind of held on to the game all night for a while, playing multiple rounds. That said, I wouldn't say this game's for everyone. This is not a game with universal appeal, because this is a card game. And a fairly traditional playing card style of card game, a set collection game. Like all playing card games, there is a lot of randomness, and luck of the draw is going to be a thing.
I like that this game is easy to teach, and that it's an easy step up for people who play traditional card games.
Yes, this is very much a gateway card game. Super easy to take your standard card player, anyone who's used to any sort of game like this, and you can bring them along on a path into hobby games with this win.
So overall, King's Coalition is being a big hit for us. I think this is a great game to help launch a new company, and I think it's going to appeal to a large range of gamers, which is perfect for a startup. It's got a nice short play time, but doesn't feel like a small game. Every game of King's Coalition I played has been interesting and tense, and I never know until the cards are revealed at the end if I've got a chance of winning or not.
I love how quickly it plays. It's light and quick and easy, while still having just enough meat on its bones to keep me satisfied.
If you dig traditional card games, especially set collection games, gin, rummy, that type of thing, you really should pick up King's Coalition. Now, if you like modern dedicated deck card games, you should also check this out. Set collection board game fans will probably also like it. And anyone who's looking for a thinky filler, short games with plenty of depth, especially once you move on to the advanced rules, you're going to find that here.
Now, due to the straightforward rules, there's plenty of room for chat and banter at the table while playing. You don't need to worry about deep focus and distraction, as the game flows quite smoothly.
Now, if you don't like card games, due to the luck of the draw element, you can probably skip King's Coalition. Though if you happen to have a chance to do a demo or play a round, give it a shot. You might just enjoy it. Now, one final note. I have heard this game compared to Fantasy Realms many times. It's Fantasy Realms light, or it's a toned down Fantasy Realms, or it's Fantasy Realms where the card powers aren't ridiculous. Now, I'm sorry to say we have not played Fantasy Realms, so I can't actually comment on that myself. Now, others have said, if you dig Fantasy Realms, give this a shot. So take that as it is.
Well, that's the end of our review of King's Coalition. It's time to reveal our hands and add up the points.
Now, if you've enjoyed this review, let us know by giving us a thumbs up, like, retweet, blog, etc. Even better would be to do that and leave us a comment, because we love comments. Steal the crown, win the game. Power, glory, and wealth await the righteous goblin ruler, the one to hold the crooked crown.
The Crooked Crown is a new Take That card game from Outset Media, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. I also want to thank him for introducing us to Kedrick Winks, one of the game's designers, who was designed along with Ken Boiter. It was Kedrick that taught us how to play and sold us on the game during a memorable Origins Game Fair morning.
The Crooked Crown plays 3 to 6 players, with games being very quick, with most games lasting well under half an hour. It's very quick to pick up, and the lack of any text on the cards makes it a great game for kids as well as adults.
In The Crooked Crown, the players are a bunch of goblins fighting over a beaten and battered crown. All that matters in the game is that you are the player holding the Crooked Crown at the end of 8 chaotic rounds of card stealing, card peeking, and hand manipulation.
The Crooked Crown comes in a small box that's designed to hold the cards and keep them safe. Cards themselves are of good quality, and they even give you a bonus crown card just in case that one very important card gets damaged. There's even a special place in the box insert to hold the spare card, which I thought was a nice touch. In addition to the cards and rules, you also get some goblin standees, stands for them, a cardboard crown, and a board for tracking players' hand size and which round it is.
Alberto S. Ballesteros' rather silly card art fits the game so well, and the art and iconography make the cards very easy to read during play. You can see all of this in our The Crooked Crown unboxing video on YouTube.
Start The Crooked Crown by everyone picking a goblin and placing their standee on the 5 spot on the board. The crown starts at the bottom of the steps on the 1 spot, and everyone gets a hand of 5 cards, making sure the Crooked Crown is one of the cards dealt out.
Each turn, the active player will play a set of matching cards, do the action for those cards, and then draw up to their current hand limit. Then the next player will go and do the same. Once play gets back to the start player, the crown gets moved up 1 step on the board, and at the end of the 8th round, when the crown is sitting on the throne, the player who has the Crooked Crown card wins.
Playing a set of spy cards lets you look at the hand of 1 player per spy card you played.
Each ambush card played reduces the hand size of one of your opponents. You get to pick which opponents. Hand size is tracked using the standees on the board. Affected players must immediately discard down to their new hand size.
When you play tasty pie cards, you increase your hand size, immediately drawing cards up to your new hand size. Hand size can range from as small as 2 to as large as 7.
Steal cards let you steal 1 card from an opponent for each steal card played. This is done blindly.
Finally, there are wild cards. Those just have to be paired with a non-wild card and counts as another card, as the same type, in a set.
If the draw deck ever runs out, you just reshuffle the discards.
That's it. That's all there is to The Crooked Crown.
Yeah, usually we tell you that our rule overviews are overviews and don't cover everything. I think we pretty much covered everything in this case. The game is that simple, and to me, that's one of the best things about The Crooked Crown. How simple it is. This is a fast and furious Take That game. It's quick to learn right out of the box. The win condition is dead simple, and there are only 5 card types you need to learn. And honestly, one of those is wild, so there's only really 4 things you have to learn.
Yeah, 4 types of things that can happen, really, which makes it super easy to teach. I do find as I'm explaining it to people, sometimes they just don't quite get it until that first round is played and you can see it click in. It's also helpful to know that someone has a Crooked Crown. You need to remember that it's seeded into the starting hands and it's not in the deck.
Yeah, this is a bluffer's game, but it's also not, since you can find out and know the information, but then that information can change and you won't always know when it may have changed.
Yeah, this is a game of back and forth, right? Hands changing hands, cards changing hands, discards, draws, mixing and matching and peeking and trying to remember who has what. Now, I've got to admit, this is the kind of game I probably would have completely missed if it wasn't for Kedrick insisting we play it after he taught us his game Shadow Ninjas, which Shadow Ninjas is awesome. Check out our review for more about that cat-themed one versus many game, hugely popular locally. But I'm just not a big party game fan, so a party game really has to stick out to win us over, and Kedrick managed to do that with The Crooked Crown.
Yeah, there is nothing about this game that would have normally led me to trying it out, and I'm glad we did give it a try.
Yeah, so this is the sort of light, fun game that can really appeal to me. While there is a level of concentration needed, it's not so much that you can't be enjoying yourself and the people around you. It's also quick enough that if you do slip and miss something, it's not the end of the world and you can deal up another round.
Now, what I really enjoyed about this game is the fact that right from the start, you know someone has the crown, or you have it. And the game is immediately about figuring out who that is, who's got the crown, or how do I get the crown? This involves playing the right cards, but more than that, I think the big draw of this game and a big part of this game is bluffing. When you know who has the crown, not only do you want to try to get it, you want to try to mislead the other players into thinking that someone else has it. Maybe even thinking you have it if you don't, when you do know where it is. And when you do have it, you better be trying to bluff people into thinking someone else has it. Like if someone steals a card from you and they don't get the crown, you better be going, oh, you got the crown from me, right? Just so that everyone else thinks you stole the crown. And then you get to see their bluffing skills like, no, I didn't get the crown. I got garbage, right? To me, that's the fun of this game. While you could play the crooked crown in complete silence and just play the cards, it's that social aspect to me that makes it fun.
Yeah, totally. This game can be fun if you are silly and over the top with your bluffing. If you just sit and stare down your opponents, it's going to be kind of meh.
Everyone chatting and socially lubricated is the ideal frame for this game.
Now, because having to bluff to really enjoy the game is what makes it fun, it does mean it's going to turn the game off to some players. Not everyone enjoys bluffing games, and that's fine. Not every game is for everyone, and that's awesome. In addition to that, the Crooked Crown is a take that game. This is a game with a lot of player interaction and tons of backstabbing. If you don't like that style of game, this isn't going to somehow magically win you over.
And I do not like that style of game. And I'm going to be honest and say it's not for me. I am never going to seek out the Crooked Crown, but I'm also not going to try and avoid playing it. And I have had fun playing this game. My kids love this game, so I enjoy playing it with them. With the right group, I'm going to have a good time, even though it's not the style of game I normally enjoy.
Now, for me, this is a great social at the bar sort of game. Quick fun and social with a bunch of people you don't mind some bluffing with.
Overall, I found the Crooked Crown to be a great filler game and a good one for a relaxed social game night. It reminds me a bit of the Deadlies, which we reviewed before, that part where someone has the halo and everyone is doing their damnedest to get that card. Except in the Crooked Crown, that's the entire game from round one. All the way from round one to eight, it's that intenseness of trying to get that one card and figure out who has it.
Yeah, that's a good comparison. I hadn't thought of that. The halo card and the Deadlies. That's spot on. And, you know, again, it's because that Crooked Crown is seeded into the starting hands, it would be a completely different, slower, less interesting, less tense game if you were playing until someone found it in the deck, even if it was seeded towards the beginning, right? So I think that's part of the brilliance there in the game design.
And when we picked up this game, I thought it was going to be big in a couple places. Now, first off, I thought my kids would dig it. And I also thought it'd be good for Gwen's high school board game club. Her group seems to really enjoy those quick playing lighter games and games with take that elements. And so far, it's been a big hit with her friend group. The other place I thought it would shine is for our local game nights that I host here in Windsor. And I wasn't surprised at all to find that the Crooked Crown was especially popular with people who were enjoying some pints at the Walkerville Brewery.
Yeah, I know Gwen broke this game out with her friends to play at her birthday party, and they loved it. And I know she's planning on bringing it to Board Game Club at her school when it starts back up next week. I think it's a perfect fit for the style of games that her group likes to play, which means it's probably also the perfect fit for other folks who enjoy lighter, quick games with bluffing and take that elements. For the style of game that it is, I think it is excellent.
If you are looking for that light, silly card game, something that can be enjoyed by kids but is also fun for adults, especially with some adult beverages involved, you should check out the Crooked Crown.
On the other hand, if you don't like light party games, don't like take that games, or aren't comfortable with bluffing, check out some of Outset's other games.
Like, say, Zensu, my favorite abstract strategy game.
Well, it's the end of the review. Who's holding the crown?
Not me. Oh, there it is. It's Deanna. Deanna is the new king of the goblins.
Well, take that games are very hit or miss with us. Some we absolutely adore, like the Deadlies, others not so much. The Crooked Crown was one that hit for us. What's a take that game that you really enjoy? Let us know about it, and maybe we'll find time to give it a shot.
All this backstabbing's hard work. I think your new king needs a coffee. You can procure one at tabletopbellhop.com/coffee.
Today, we welcome a new team to the arena. let's get the lowdown on Jaws and Dimiti, a robot pack expansion for Robot Quest Arena from Wise Wizard Games. We have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy of this expansion.
So the Jaws Robot Pack adds more than just a new bot to your games of Robot Quest Arena, the deck-building game of robot battles. Now, before we dig into the expansion, for any of you who don't know Robot Quest Arena, be sure to check out our review, which was part of episode 245 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast. All I'll say here is this game has been a huge hit locally, and I've been really enjoying adding these bot expansions to it.
The Jaws expansion is one of three robot packs currently available for Robot Quest Arena. Each of these includes a new bot you can play, additional health tokens, new cards, and new battlefield tiles. They also each increase the player count of Robot Quest Arena by one, allowing you to play with more players or in larger team games.
A big surprise for us when we opened up the Kettle expansion pack, which we reviewed as part of episode 250, was that there were totally new rules in the expansion, and that is true with this pack as well. The new cards you get aren't just more of the same, they feature a new type of card.
So the one new thing you get with Jaws are light blue upgrade cards. When you buy one of these cards from the market, you put it directly in play next to your robot card. It stays there for the remainder of the game, giving you a new permanent ability. Examples being the ability to move one square further every turn, extra energy each round, and more.
The other new thing that comes with Jaws are totally new battlefield tiles, two new two-sided tiles, and a button. One of the tiles is a grate with flames coming out of it, and the other is a pit. Each has a closed, safe side and an open, dangerous side. The button is special, as it can be attacked like a bot. When the button gets attacked or moved onto, all of the two-sided tiles flip over. The fire tile only causes damage, whereas if a bot falls in the pit, it's instantly destroyed.
The rules for these new elements are on cards, which is great. You can just put them out beside the board so everyone can reference as needed.
And I said it the last time reviewing Kettle, and I'll say it again. I love these expansions. These are awesome. They just bring me joy. They're packed like old school action figures, and that tickles my nostalgia. And then they add lots of cool stuff to a game I love. Like, I adore the fact you're not just getting a new playing piece. You're getting new rules for the game and new options as well.
So the button and traps here are a great addition, as it brings the first item, the pit, that's a one-shot kill. But It makes it hard to use, so it's not super overpowered. Setting up the board is really underrated fun part of this game, and I think now, based on our play and all these new board tiles that they keep adding to us, the manual does the aspect of setting up the board a real disservice.
Yeah, I would love Wise Wizard to put out some maps, like give me some sample board layouts. Give me some cool things that I might not have thought of doing. There aren't even suggestions on how to set up the board. Like, if everyone takes a random tile, I would love to see something like that. So we talked about the new tiles and new cards. What we didn't actually mention is Jaws, the new bot. Jaws has the standard 5 health, and they do 1 additional damage on the first melee attack they do each turn. And I got to say, that's a solid ability. And I dig the way it makes you focus on close quarter combat. The more I play Robot Quest Arena, the more I tend to see players favoring the ranged weapons over the melee ones. So it's cool to see a bot that specializes in close combat.
Yeah, the varieties of specialties in the bots is really interesting to see, as with 6 bots now in our collection, they all feel unique in their own way, but not better or worse, except when one or another might fit better into your own personal playstyle. Like, if you like the melee, then Jaws may be your one.
And I like the new upgrade cards. They're a cool addition to the game, and there's a good variety of card types and costs. At first, I was a little worried. Like, when I first read the rules on these, I was like, ooh, this sounds like it's going to give players who buy them too much of an advantage, especially because you don't even have to draw them from your deck. They go right into play. But I haven't actually seen that play out that way at the table. Like, so far, the benefits they give are nice, but they're not amazing. They're not overpowering, and they do come at the cost of buying weapons and shields and energy generation cards that are going to keep coming up in your deck over and over. Like everything else we've seen in Robot Quest Arena, they seem well-balanced, well-playtested, and seem to work well with everything else.
Indeed, I do wonder when they might hit the wall and accidentally unbalance something with an expansion, but they certainly have not done that yet.
Now, as for the battlefield tiles, they're one of my favorite additions of this. I like buttons in games. It reminds me a bit of Robo Rally. and I am a huge Robo Rally fanboy. I like that I now have this button I can attack or move over. I love putting the pit right in the center of the battlefield. And I got to say, there's not much else in this game as rewarding as pushing a bot, especially one at full health with lots of shields on it, down that pit.
If you own Robot Quest Arena, you need to pick up this expansion. I would even suggest picking this one up before Kettle. This expansion is less fiddly than the shield and portal rules added by Kettle, and Jaws is a better bot for new players. Though honestly, the true recommendation so far is pick up all the expansions.
Yeah, seriously. These are awesome. I love these expansions. These are some of my favorite expansions ever produced for a board game ever. At this point, our copy of Robot Quest Arena has 6 bots, plays up to 6 players. You can play teams of 3. And also worth noting, everything so far fits in the base game box, which I appreciate. We did have to toss out the plastic tray that was holding the original minis, but these miniatures are like, I don't know, they're chonky. They remind me of like Amiibos or Skylander or some of those Disney Infinity pieces and stuff like that. There's a certain type of pre-painted plastic that is very solid. And I have no worries that anything's going to break by being tossed loose in the box. Now, at this point, we do have one more expansion on our shelf of shame to check out, and that is Dozer. Now, this one was a Kickstarter exclusive, but I did note that Wise Wizard Game did have it at Origin. So you should be able to pick it up at cons. I'm not sure it's available on their website, but this one looks cool. Looking a bit ahead, now that I know that everything comes with new rules, I know that it adds random elements to the game where you're going to have random events where you're going to like draw a card to change something in the battlefield. I did not look up to see what the battlefield toy tiles are, though, so that's going to be a surprise. And I can't wait to check out that final expansion for Robot Quest Arena.
What about you? Have you played Robot Quest Arena? We want to know which of the bot teams is your favorite. Let us know in the comments or hit us up on social media.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock those lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Thank you to the members of the Misdirected Mark Gaming Podcast.
Donna, thanks, Pax.
Evil John, thanks, John.
Thanks, Tycho.
Brian Kurtz, thank you, Brian.
Chris Leary, thank you.
Your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast. Pocket Casts has added the ability to review podcasts in the app, so it would be awesome for those of you that use it, and I know some of you are out there, leave us a review in your app.
Yep, probably the single thing we would love most in the universe right now is reviews. If you enjoyed the show, please head over to Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen and leave us a review and help others discover the show.
And we're not just a podcast. You can get even more Bellhop at tabletopbellhop.com with written articles and reviews or by joining our Patreon. Get access to weekly show notes, bonus audio, outtakes, first thoughts, reviews, and more. That's all for us tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.